We're in Fallujah, everybody.
Right. Oh, I'm sad now.
Why?
This is where she gets gunned down in the bay.
Yes.
Oh.
But there is conflict on Fallujah before that happens.
This world's upsetting. Just the visuals. Yeah. Star Wars is...
Star Wars is what?
I'm trying to think of how to phrase my, like, current thought right now. About, like, how, you go to planets like this. Yeah, you go to planets like this, and there's, like, a roots bigger than a city. Or skyscraper. Really makes people insignificant.
Yeah.
And on planets where, like, the days are, like, years long, are there aliens that live for, like, a billion years because of that?
Yeah, time is relative to a species.
But, like, oh, what if you're, like, a human who's born on, like, a planet with, like, a... No, that's not how it works. I'm being stupid.
Yeah, that's not how it works.
I'm being really stupid right here.
Do you mean, like, how different species age differently?
Yeah, I was saying, like, yeah, like, Yoda's race, are they on a planet where, like, a day for them is, like, a year and a half? It takes their...
Well, we don't know, because technically we don't know anything about Yoda's race.
But are there, like, examples of stuff similar to that?
Yeah.
Or, like, alien life... You think about life on other planets, the conditions vary so much. Will there be, like, immortals to us? There may even be species that live, like, a month. Because there's Earth spinning... Or the planet's spinning so fast and they evolve that way, like fruit flies. They live for, like, 6 hours, 8 hours.
Yep.
That's upsetting to think about.
There's a couple episodes in Clone Wars that do some weird stuff like that, actually. And I think, yeah, they're usually the R2 C3PO droid episodes.
It's cool they explore that stuff.
Yeah, they do. Like I said, one of the only reasons, and I've realized this over the last couple of days after seeing Rise of Skywalker, and after seeing Mandalorian season 1 finale. Is the only reason I'm still in love with Star Wars the way I am is because of Dave Filoni.
Is he on Mandalorian?
He is... Hold on. Come here, you bastard!
Shoot, ninja.
He is the other showrunner for Mando behind Jon Favreau. Or at least Jon Favreau is, like, the creator, and he's the other dude that's, like, directing and writing and producing it.
Okay. He's like, okay, I see. It's like, Mark Frost and David Lynch?
Pretty much, yes. They're the better, They're the better, David Benioff and D.B. Weiss.
Mike Frost. I don't know who those names are.
Good. You don't need to, Pat.
Oh, is that Game of Thrones guys?
Yes, it is.
Dude, Game of Thrones.
Witcher makes it better.
Really?
Yes, it does.
I always pass on the Witcher series because I just didn't like Geralt's design.
Geralt.
Jarl, though.
It's not Gary, it's Jerry. That's what you have to remember. Geralt. It's Gary, not Jerry.
Geralt, okay.
Geralt, not okay. Geralt.
Yeah, I played the second one for Xbox and just couldn't get into it.
Yeah, second one is very, very difficult. I played the second one after I played the third, just because I had to, and then I went back to play the first, and I was like, dear God, I cannot do this.
Oh, I heard the first is, like, proper...
Piece of shit.
It's, like, proper Slav computer game.
Yeah, it is.
Some Polish bugs in it.
Yeah, it is. But the third one is just great.
I have heard nothing but good things.
I mean, there's some funny bugs, but that's just also because their dev team is no longer focused on it anymore.
Mm. Oh, yeah, they're on Cyberpunk.
Which is fine. I mean, I'm totally cool with that.
I'm ready for Cyberpunk.
Same. I'm ready to, fuck shit up with Keanu Reeves.
I hope you get to pick your faction.
I feel like you will. I feel like you'll be able to.
So there's, like, a clown gang, and there's, like, a...
What?!
In the board game, there's punk. Cyber, like, literal punk cyberpunk. But it's like, yeah, it's so cool. There's
a
corporate...
I'm choosing clowns.
They look kind of dumb.
Well,
I don't know what they're doing in the new game. In the old board game from like the 70s or 80s or whatever, they like the like Bozo the Clown in Cyberpunk setting.
Man, that's kind of scary though.
It's scary, but like, if I'm gonna be a clown, I'm not gonna be a clown anyways. The clown game isn't for me from the start, but you should check it out. I'll look at it. Just some, like, heavily modified body people that look like models in Schwarzenegger.
Cool.
I think. It's been a while since I saw, like, people break out.
I thought that was... guys.
Let's talk Rise of Skywalker as someone who's seen it, and I've never seen it. I haven't seen the last two.
What the fuck, Pat? Then I shouldn't talk about it.
I'm not gonna watch them. I'm not gonna watch.
Okay, for someone who's seen all three.
I've heard the plot points, the central plot points.
Someone who has seen all three, it completely retcons Last Jedi.
Okay.
It completely retcons Episode 8. You do not need to see Episode 8 going in to see Episode 9. And that is bad.
Okay, I did see some of Episode 8. I saw the part where they open the... They're in space, and they open the bomber hatch for their ship.
Yeah, that's
Episode 8. I wanted to throw up.
That's the beginning.
Okay.
It's the beginning of Episode 8.
I wanted to throw up. That makes no sense.
Should not sit here.
Am I being an asshole?
They're in low orbit, so there is still technically some gravity.
They're like so above the planet.
I know.
And the chicken breathe?
I know.
I don't know. You can do such cooler stuff in space battles.
Yeah, one of the things... There's a lot wrong with Last Jedi, so we're not gonna get into that. Oh no. I can't do it.
You got him.
Oh. I'm like, there's one more and I don't know where he went. He shot me in my ass. That's where he came from.
He jumped over your corpse. Clicked his heels together.
No shit, little fucker. Come back here. I'm gonna kill your children.
Are the robots sentient? I'm sidetracking you too much. Last Jedi.
So, completely retcons Last Jedi. Like, you don't need to see it.
Okay. But what about I can't think of anything.
Leia. Leia was a good send-off. They could only do so much with what footage Carrie Fisher did shoot. Ultimately, it was a good movie. I mean, it wasn't a great movie. It wasn't fan-fucking-tastic or anything, but it was a pretty good movie. Like, there are still some issues with it, and there's going to be issues just where Last Jedi left things. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be able to fix everything from it. So with that said, I felt the majority of the movie was kind of just them fixing shit. And it was essentially like three movies worth of exposition in one movie that was shittily
slapped together,
where it's like you're reading the cliff notes. You're getting the story, but you know there's more there that you want, and you're not gonna ever get the opportunity to get that, and if you do... All the shit is going to be answered in, like, a third-party media, like a comic or a novel or something. Which, granted, the prequel and the sequel movies did do. And here, this is something that, just for anonymity purposes, this is what my girlfriend agrees with me with. Not just because she's my girlfriend and she's just a piece. And she's just like, yeah, honey, no problem.
Sure, yes. Star Wars.
No, she's saying this as a fucking Star Wars nerd.
Yeah, she is, yeah.
Yes, Pat, you know. She's saying it as a Star Wars nerd that this sequel trilogy just did not have a roadmap. It didn't have a plan of where it was going to go, of what anything it was going to do, or character development, of plot lines, or anything. Which is why every time I watch one of these movies, I don't feel like anything's changed, and that's why I don't feel like Rey is a progressive, or not progressive, she is a progressive character. I wouldn't say she doesn't progress as a character. She doesn't advance in... She doesn't gain XP. if you want to put it like that. She doesn't feel fleshed out. She does after seeing Rise of Skywalker, she does. And I was like, man, if I could have gotten three movies like this instead of one. Because it humanized her and actually made me give a shit. One thing I actually liked about Rise of Skywalker, which I did like a lot about it, one of the things I did like, which isn't in, like, Force Awakens or Last Jedi, is it shows her struggling. Or at least it shows her, like, failing at shit and then being impacted by her failures. Like, we fail, not because of me, but, like, I could have done something. She puts the onus on her. She takes the heat, as opposed to, oh, whatever, we'll just go on happy-go-lucky, and we'll pick up next time, guys.
You get that in the first and second movie of the original trilogy.
You get that with the original trilogy, but there's also, like, a sense of loss, like, once Biggs dies in A New Hope. Once Uncle Ben dies. Once, like, Luke's friend from Biggs. Once Luke's friend from Tatooine dies during the Death Star assault, you're like, oh, shit, this is some real-life shit. That's, like, a realization wake-up moment for Luke. Is that this is some real stakes here. I mean, she kind of has that once Han dies, but she's still like, okay, everybody, let's keep going.
Yeah, I thought the first movie was like a call to adventure.
I will say this about Force Awakens. Force Awakens feels like a love letter to Star Wars.
Yeah, it's like one-to-one, kind of, almost.
Yes, to the point where it feels like you're ripping off A New Hope.
Yeah.
But it's not bad. It's not in a bad way. Like I said, it feels like it's like an ode to Star Wars. It's a love letter to Star Wars.
Yeah. And I was fine with that. I liked it for the first.
I was like that, yeah.
The first entry into the new, then let's do new stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Do new stuff, like, not this new stuff.
Well, see, the thing is, with the roadmap, is that J.J. Abrams wrote, at least from what I thought, or at least the information I gathered, I was led to believe he wrote scripts for all three movies. Mm. He didn't know what they were going to be called yet, but he was essentially like, these are the scripts for the new trilogy of movies. I have to go work on a new movie.
Disney, can you wait?
Or Disney, I know you can't wait. Ryan Johnson, here's the script for it. Ryan Johnson reads it. I don't like any of this. Throws it out the window as he wipes his shit with it.
To be fair, as a director, I wouldn't want
to... To be fair, I wouldn't want to direct someone else's thing. Yeah, I'd want to put my own spin on it. But to the point where he just kind of blatantly fucks up Star Wars... And to the point where they have to completely retcon the entire movie that he made, to the point where you don't need to see it upon going to see the final movie in that trilogy, that's bad. That is bad filmmaking, that is bad poor directing.
I would say it's like...
What is happening? I'm stuck like this.
You're gonna turn?
No? I didn't think I was.
What else happened? Whoa!
Someone kill me!
I think it's bugging, yeah.
Oh. That's one of the very first EA bugs I've gotten in a very long time, I will say. Anyway.
But I think with Ryan Johnson's thing, it's very corporate. It just feels... I wouldn't say it's him. I'd say it's more like how Disney views it all as cookie cutter. Oh, JJ's gone? Just get... Hire another freaking Mook.
Well, I would say that about...
Wait, is Mook a racist term?
What's a Mook?
A Mook, what's a Mook?
I don't know.
What's a Mook?
In terms of just way I feel like the Disney Star Wars aspect is being run, yes, I feels like it's very cookie cutter. However, I feel like it's being run that way because they see what Marvel did and how everything was specific beats. The problem with that is Marvel had a plan for like fucking 15 years and they needed to hit specific things. And they went and they approached certain directors like, okay, you need to include this in your shit.
Yeah.
It's okay, you can create grave differences. Granted, they came in and there was a good amount of studio interference, and I didn't like that. But ultimately, it's because they need the story to move a certain direction. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I don't feel like Rian Johnson's Last Jedi was good in that aspect, because it doesn't feel like a Star Wars movie, but there's more to it than that. It's not well-written. It doesn't respect the characters or what Star Wars is.
I just, my biggest gripe, I think I've told you this before. I haven't seen I keep saying new because it was new a minute ago. The Rian Johnson one, but the...
Technically it's new. Yeah. It's part of the new trilogy, but yes, Last Jedi.
The light jump.
Haldo Maneuver, as it's called, yes. In this Rise of Skywalker movie. It's called the Haldo Maneuver after the chick that did it. That was cool.
But that's like one of the... Oh, it's having issues?
No, it's fine.
Okay. But that's like one of those things where Star Wars is like... It was a hero's journey in the start. Everything was vague. It was more about the call to adventure.
Oh.
And the first movie's like the best because, you know, the Star Run and all that stuff.
Yeah.
When Obi-Wan speaks to him like twice in the movie.
Yeah.
And the second time's at the penultimate moment and all that. I love that stuff. That hits home.
Yeah.
But being a kid, you see them doing light jumps and all that stuff, and you think, oh, I wonder if, like, even as, like, a, I don't even remember how old I was, but I remember thinking, like, oh, I wonder how they don't hit anything. And I assume it's just
because calculations?
Yeah, but it's, like, never directly explained.
They do in Empire, though.
In Empire?
Yeah.
They calculate it?
Yes. That's the whole thing. That's why Han can't escape, because he's having trouble the making calculations field. For the light jump from the debris field.
Yeah. But, again, less computer thing, like, I always figured it was
but
impossible.
But that was a question.
Yeah.
Was, like, how do they not hit anything?
Yeah. I always figured it was impossible to hit something practically.
Like, yes.
You couldn't light jump. Because that's, like, the ultimate weapon. As in that movie demonstrates.
It's also a suicide bomb.
Well, but there's droids. We have drone technology now.
Yeah, but here's the problem.
You just kamikaze a steel box.
Pat, I'm just gonna throw a monkey wrench in there and saying that Star Wars people see droids as not machines. Yeah, they see them as machines and tools, but they see them as individual beings with their own personality. So it would be sad when they just say, like, you're gonna go here and do this. That's an Empire thing to do, buddy.
But you can remote control. We have drones right now. They have spaceships. They can do.
I know.
Remote control.
Once again, still a hole in Rian Johnson's story. You're just adding to the
fire. Yeah, I'm saying that was my biggest critique of the whole, like.
Yeah, that's fucking cool set piece.
Yeah.
Was completely superfluous and didn't need to happen.
Yeah. Where I'm like, why is it a suicide mission?
Exactly. Even? It doesn't need to happen. The other thing with, well, we're getting a lot off track with Last Jedi, because Last Jedi is just a steamy pile of shit. But I feel like the reason that this trilogy of movies that wasn't so great is because there wasn't a roadmap for things. There wasn't, like, a set end for each movie. There wasn't a set beginning for each movie. Yeah. For the original trilogy and the prequels, the Hayden Christensen, Ewan McGregor, Natalie Portman trilogy, as bad as you could say it was, because, yes, it was bad at times. Yes, there was cringy fucking dialogue.
The
CG was shitty. That's also because, let's just say it, George Lucas is not the best at writing romance.
No, you see some of it.
That's why in Empire, it's a different dude writing the dialogue for the B side characters, or the B plot, the character development. Because George Lucas is a big picture kind of guy. But however you want to say it, those prequel trilogy. And the original trilogy, they started and ended in a different way. That is, the galaxy was not the same as it started or ended. Dear God.
The hero's journey was complete.
The hero's journey was complete. The characters did not start and end the same way in those movies. They evolved. They went through character development. They were changed throughout the course of the movie, and they are no longer the same characters they were when the movie started. I do not feel that way with these, with not just Rey, with Rey or Finn or Poe.
What happens with Finn?
He's fine. I think he's alive.
Get him! I remember the first trailer for The Force Awakens. I was like really hyped.
Oh, do you mean no Jedi or anything? None of that.
No.
They had the opportunity. Are they gonna do that? No.
But like Finn's character thing, where he takes off the helmet and he talks like, I don't know what I've been fighting for or something. We're gonna have like a moral discussion, or he's gonna be a character to explore the morality of war.
Let me get into that shit, because there's a thing that was brought up in Force Awakens that is just completely moved to the side. Pretty much just. The trilogy just didn't have a roadmap, and that's why I feel like one of the reasons why there was such a problem. So going with that, let's use Finn as a prime example. Like you just said, we're gonna have a dialogue about war, kids, in a Star Wars movie, which they totally do in Clone Wars, which is supposed to be a fucking children's show.
The first one, too.
I'm talking about the Dave Filoni animated TV show for children. And they talk about clones executing and killing their friends that they, like, have known for years. And not being able to control their bodies while doing so, and coming to PTSD. They get into some heavy shit.
Clone Wars has the core theme of, like, the first casualty of war is innocence and all that.
Yeah, they really hit home with the actual animated Dave Filoni TV show with the 7 seasons and everything, but there's no real heavy casualty of war in this new trilogy or anything. I mean, unless you want to count, like, main characters who die. I mean, and possibly those other planets that get destroyed at the beginning of Force Awakens, but you're like, okay, whatever.
Yeah, how much time do you spend on those planets?
You don't know anybody on those fucking things, so it's like, okay, I don't know what that is. But... I'm just gonna go up there. But one of the things with Finn, with Rise of Skywalker specifically, is there's this new character, and I forget what her name is, but, she is also a defecting
First Order
stormtrooper who is hiding out on one of the other moons of Endor. That's where they find the wreckage of the Death Star in the trailers and stuff. And her little group that she her little group she's with is a bunch of another pack of defective stormtroopers. Mm. And he's like, oh shit, I didn't know that there was more of us. And then she asks who he was, and then he says that he's FN2187, and she knows who he is. Mm-hmm. And how he was an inspiration for all of them to, like, defect. Mm. And they kind of have a little dialogue about how they were at this battle, and their CEO gave them an officer that they didn't agree with, and they just laid down their arms.
Yeah.
But through the rest of the movie, when they show stormtroopers who they had just got through saying that they're people with thoughts and feelings who don't want to do this, and they're conscripted to do this, and, like, essentially taken and forced into being a child soldier.
Yeah.
He's running around shooting them in the face, and every time he does, he's like, woo!
That's, yeah. That's
woo! Woo!
Let me ask a question from, like, an area.
Oh, no! Oh!
You're done.
Yeah, I probably am, but continue.
Oh, no, good enough. From a narrative standpoint, do those same clone the defectors?
Oh, they come back into it.
Do they come back and fight?
Yes.
That's horrible writing. I hate that.
They come back and fight in the conflict with the First Order again? Yeah, they come back and fight at the end.
Okay, I'm thinking like a more altruistic, like full on. I could see like you'd think there'd be a scene where like Finn's like, come on guys, we gotta fight. And if they're defectors are like,
no.
They'd be full pacifists, like, no, we dropped our guns a long time ago, Finn. We'll stay here, if they slaughter us, they slaughter us. We're not killing anymore, it's the principle of it. They were once us.
Yeah. They had the opportunity to do something like
that. Yeah, that's what I'm saying, when you describe that thing, I'm like, I hope they didn't join the rebellion right away. It's like, I think it's like a, there's a film called The Mission, where it's De Niro, and I think, I can't remember his name right now. But anyways, it's a mission where slave traders are coming to crush the mission in South America.
Mm-hmm.
And De Niro's a former slave catcher himself, who's reformed by the church, and he loves the people the mission helps. And when he knows that the Portuguese are coming for the slave trade to take all the members of the mission and destroy the church, him and the main priest argue about, we gotta fight him off, and the preacher argues that you gotta... killing is wrong no matter what. If they're gonna kill us, they're gonna kill us. It's in the hands of God. And there's a great scene where De Niro's trying to lead they're shooting bows and arrows, and they're trying to stop the slave traders, and the preacher is like hosting a sermon for all the women and children as the villagers get burnt around them by the slave traders, and he's just walking. He just walks with like the cross in his hands at like a row of rifles and gets shot. It's a powerful message. That character's great. So when you describe that thing with the separate or the defectors, I could see them having like an equal like conflict's wrong. We're not being soldiers anymore, Finn. If you feel you have to fight, you can still choose to fight.
But do they do that?
We're exploring the other aspect of full pacifist of like, it's not even the war's not even worth engaging. If they're gonna kill us, they're gonna kill us. We can't take on that evil. I know it's Star Wars and.
And ultimately, which just, if you're gonna just talk about idealism, I ultimately don't agree with, because this, as a person...
Oh, no, yeah.
Fuck that.
Full pacifist is hard.
Yeah, with
but
that...
But it's respectable. Just,
it's respectable, yes. And I honor you, and I think you're an honorable and a very moralistic and great person, but, I mean, ultimately you're going to die, and that's a waste of a great person. So I would say... fight and then live to spread your morals, or at the very least, you know, not fucking just willingly sit there and die. A fleeing motion might benefit you.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I think that... I'm thinking of stuff where it's not an option to flee.
No, I know, but in that option, obviously, the option...
Obviously, defect again, flee.
Yeah, but in the case of Star Wars where you're saying, like, oh, they're gonna have this... No. They're gonna have this whole big, like...
They can have that, and Finn can help
like,
them.
Commentary? No, yeah.
Finn
not.
Can help them escape and continue on.
Yeah, no, peaceful no, they don't. They don't. If anything, the actual chick, she helps blow up some Star Destroyers.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Are they manned by people?
Yes.
Oh. Woo! Hop in. I think that's a symptom of the times, too, though.
But they actually make a kind of statement in Rise of Skywalker. So there's a bunch of new Star Destroyers that Emperor Palpatine...
Yeah. I saw the trailer, and I've read the leaks.
Yeah. For more of who are true... Die, bitch!
Oh, you almost had...
Who killed you? You are mine. Come at me. Hey. I'm gonna be all stealthy. Actually, you know what? This isn't gonna help me. All right, let's go do this.
So you're going to sniper in a hangar conflict? What do they explain?
They explain that there's a bunch of new Star Destroyers that get made, and everyone who is manning the Star Destroyers are essentially loyal and wholly loyal to Palpatine.
Okay.
So, they're bad guys.
Okay.
And you're not gonna... Yeah, no one's gonna miss if they die. Essentially. So you don't have any, like apathy about killing them. You know?
Yeah.
You're like, okay, it's fine. But... Ooh, for the most part, I did like the movie. Like I said, it's not like a great movie. There's stuff that's wrong with it, but that's also just because I feel like... It feels very much like J.J. Abrams was just like, I just want to be done.
Yeah. Here's all your...
Here it is.
Everything up. She's
more or less tying it up. Suck it. Suck it, Grievous. I killed you. Ha ha!
Can we talk about the ending? I'll spoil the ending real quick. It's like a warning.
Spoil the ending. Spoiler alert for the ending,
yeah,
everybody.
Stop right now.
The ending was actually one of the things I didn't like about it. It was one of the very few things I didn't like about it. I would say in the grand total, there's probably about four things I don't like about this movie. Three of which are in the ending.
Like the, what's the first thing?
First
return
thing.
Return the Tatooine.
Let's go in order.
Okay.
Let's go in order of the events that happened in the movie. First thing is, I don't like, or I don't think, found it superfluous, if you should say, found it superfluous that Ben dies after his redemption arc. I'm kind of over.
Oh, okay.
I'm very much over the trope of once the character goes through a redemption arc, they die. I know it's kind of peaceful, and they're at peace now, and they've like redeemed themselves, and they can finally rest. But at the same time, I'm just like, that needs to be fucking over, because it's ruining some pretty good character arcs that don't need to follow that trope. I'm citing Game of Thrones examples. Spoiler alert for season 8 of Game of Thrones, is Jamie's redemption arc. When he just dies.
I don't want to talk about that.
And that's bullshit. And then even before that, and what was it, season 5 or whatever, when Jon dies his first time. That's technically like a redemption arc. And then also with, even with Star Wars, even with Vader, redemption arc, dead.
I would say Vader's is the most fitting, because...
Vader's is the most fitting. Because
he's kept alive by, like, Goombas.
I will give you that one. Vader's is the most fitting ending. Also, because, you're right, he's not living technically by himself. It's the machines that are kind of doing it.
Yeah, death is a freedom.
Exactly. So, in that case, totally 100% okay. Even though, technically, if you want to get into it, they did have the technology to remove all the respirators and technically heal them to be, like, as good as new. But for the character arc... For him, it's best for him to die. But other things, no. And in Ben's case, he didn't need to die. I felt it was very superfluous. It was not necessary.
But just from describing, I think, again, back to that film, The Mission, I just gave you a brief synopsis. But you can imagine De Niro's character with the former slave trader fights.
And it just seems from that character arc, at least for both characters, De Niro's and the priest, those seems like fitting endings for those characters.
Yeah. But I mean, like, with, like, Ben...
It doesn't...
Reformed, becomes a wandering samurai equivalent, which in Star Wars is, like, very based on the tradition.
Very much, yes. Or, at the very least, he's redeemed now, and he starts a new Jedi Academy. And he follows in the footsteps of his uncle. And he starts a new Jedi Order with Rey, which would have been equally fucking cool.
Emphasis on, yeah, the...
And then emphasis
returning
on...
Returning the light. Returning the Jedi.
Yeah, so returning Jedi to where they were, but also with the new teaching of the Jedi of not to shun the darkness and actually learn its teachings and understand it, not understand that there's two sides to the Force, light and the dark side, and not one... To understand one is to be naive and not understand what the Force is in its entirety. Which is something that's kind of hinted at in Clone Wars and in the Rebel show, both Dave Filoni TV shows. Which would be something that would be fucking a great ending, but it's not in there. That was the first thing, is him dying. It was superfluous. And that comes about through mainly the whole fact that in this they introduce Force healing.
Oh, yeah.
But in that, J.J. Abrams, I love you, man, but you kind of don't... Force healing is. Good example is, have you played the Knights of the Old Republic, Pat?
Yes.
Okay, there's an ability in there called Force Heal. And you literally just heal. And it's the ability to just stitch together all of the fibers and atoms of your body to be good as new before the injury. Whatever the injury was, whether it be a broken bone or being fucking impaled. In Rise of Skywalker, it's essentially they make it so you're giving part of your life force to something else.
Mm-hmm.
And thus you, like, essentially die a little bit by giving your life force to this thing, which whatever the other party is.
Yeah.
Rey's case, the first time they show force healing in the movie, she heals this giant snake thing.
Oh yeah, I saw that. I saw a thing saying, like, that they just did that to introduce the concept.
But here's the thing.
Why would you give your life for a snake thing?
Yeah, but here's the thing, which is, here's the interesting concept of it, and I don't understand this, and we're gonna get into a little sidetrack about force healing here real quick, because it's one of the things, it couples with the reason why I don't like Ben dying, so this is why we're explaining it now. In Mandalorian, spoilers, for episode 7 of Mandalorian, Baby Yoda uses force healing. And he heals a character. That's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to say who, because then that's kind of a dick. I'll just say that he uses force healing at some point. But in that aspect, it literally is just like he's healing the person. He's stitching together the wound that the character sustained. It's no life force situation. And I'm just like, I wonder why it's like this. Oh, gee, is it because Dave Filoni actually knows what the flying fuck force healing is? Because... what J.J. Abrams is closer to describing is essence transfer. And essence transfer is also in Rise of Skywalker, and it's something that Palpatine mentions. And it's because that essence transfer is a Sith ability. Darkseid, or at least Darkseid users of Sith, do not have the ability to use light side ability, so they cannot use force healing.
So they're cool.
So their equivalent is either essence transfer, which is essentially a way to essentially live forever. It's to take possession of a new vessel by removing your spirit and putting it into a new body, essentially.
It's what all the droids.
I know, we're not going to be able to do this. I hate Naboo, man. This is why. This is the reason why. Essence transfer is essentially just the idea of removing your body and putting it into a new vessel, essentially. And Palpatine mentions that, where he, like, wants him and Rey to become one. Which just sounds disgusting. But he essentially wants to essence transfer and take possession of her body and use Rey's body as his new vessel, essentially. That's what he wants to do. Spoilers. That's essence transfer. Another version that is kind of like the dark side version of force healing is force drain, which is more vampiric in nature, if you want to say.
Exactly.
And it's like you said, it's very fucking self-explanatory. Yes. It's just you drain the life force from your target and you absorb it for yourself and heal yourself. and it's essentially the Sith version of Force healing, because it's the only thing that that's equivalent to that. And
it sounds pretty balanced.
Well, it sounds pretty balanced, lore-wise. Lore-wise. But when
Jedi's
you...
Jedi's one of her others?
Yeah.
Sith, hell yeah.
Exactly. But when it brings into Rise of Skywalker, it doesn't it sound like Force Drain is kind of synonymous with Force healing now? When I say that, like, it's...
You give life essence and that one takes life essence?
Yeah.
Excluding the possession one?
Yeah. And then, but no the weird thing is, they introduced the concept of Force healing into Disney Star Wars with Mandalorian, with Baby Yoda, but in that instance, he's not trading life force or anything, he's just healing the dude. So it's like, one of you clearly understands what Force healing is, and obviously it's Dave Filoni, the person who's actually a fan of Star Wars.
Rise of Skywalker one, it sounds essentially like the same ability, just a different target.
What do you mean?
It's between two individuals manipulating the life essence, with one taking, one giving.
It's pretty
it's like,
much.
How can they not do the other thing?
It's pretty much like, what's a better way to explain it? It is a consensual force drain. How's that? That's about what it is. I think that's a pretty good descriptor. Whereas one canon force healing, the force healing that Baby Yoda exhibited, was pretty much just the ability to heal someone and heal the very, like, fibers they're building, the molecules, and stitch it back together.
And has limitations.
You
can't put a head back on.
Obviously, you can't put a head back on, and it's kind of just however much energy the person doing the ability has, which is like why Baby Yoda passes out. Also, why he passes out when he never does any force abilities in Mando, by the way. It's just because he's a baby, and he just doesn't have the ability to sustain those force powers for long periods of time, so he passes out. And at least with his version of force healing, it's, like I said, it's actual fucking healing, whereas at least the J.J. Abrams force healing, it's like a weird consensual force drain.
What if you give all of your life essence to like a head?
I'm happy you said that, Pat! The last thing is with fucking him dying. He's getting his revenge! I don't know where he went. Okay. I'm gonna die anyway just from getting shot.
How did they have it programmed in every time these two fight? Duel in Fate's place.
Right? Anyway, so the reason Ben dies is that fucking Rey is fighting Palpatine, and she eventually kills him. There's some other equally badass parts where some fallen Jedi give her some portion of power to defeat Palpatine, and she ultimately defeats Palpatine, and then she subsequently dies. Before all this, Ben got, like, thrown into a pit. Just got yeeted into a pit by Palpatine.
That's apparently very livable in the Star Wars.
Yeah, it is. Well, I'm glad you say that, Pat, because they also explain how it's livable in Clone Wars.
What? It should...
You use the Force
Before you hit the ground?
Yeah, and create, like, a little cushion before you hit the ground. It slows you down. Anyway. Besides that, so Rey effectively dies. Kylo climbs back out of the pit, and he sees that she's dead, and she climbs over, and he, like, force heals her. He's able to do it now because he's turned to the light, so he has the ability to use light side powers again. But because he's almost dead himself, he gives all of his essence to her, and he dies after. And that's how he dies. I mean, it's kind of savage on Rey's part. It's not like she couldn't have totally given some essence back 50-50 and they would have both been okay, but, you know, fuck it.
She's like, oh.
Yeah. I'm just gonna keep all of it? Cool. So, that's to answer your question of if you give all of your essence, you die. So Ben, that's how Ben dies, essentially.
But if you give all your essence to, like, a head on the ground, will the head live?
No.
Oh. That's what I thought it was.
No.
Headbutt. All right. I didn't think of anything.
Didn't think of anything?
I was like, I should think of, like, really good points to make, and I I kind of immediately forgot.
We're back with Battlefield, and we're not on Geonosis like we said we were going to be last time.
Unless we get this.
Unless.
Let's just.
I highly doubt it, but.
Yeah, let's just go there again.
We're on Fallujah. That's okay. We were talking about Rise of Skywalker last time.
Yes, we finished with Ben.
And spoilers about. Just spoilers about the movie.
Yes.
We're talking about Ben's death and how it was not necessary.
I think I'll put a spoiler thing in
the title. Yeah, good idea. That was the one thing. That was that. And then what was the other thing that Misa had a problem with? With Rise of Skywalker. It's Ben's death. It was the Force healing, which we also talked about. Oh yeah, okay. Last two things. The very last scenes of the movie was Rey going back to Tatooine.
Yeah.
I don't mind the whole, like, burying the lightsabers and all that stuff. That's totally okay. I thought that was actually very respectful and very nice thing to do for Luke and Leia. So it wasn't that. The issue... issue I had was actually with the fact that when she shows it, it's... she has a... yellow lightsaber. That's not to say that she can't have a yellow lightsaber. I'm not mad. No, fuck no. That's awesome. I was a fan of yellow lightsabers in Legends continuity when Jedi Sentinels had yellow lightsabers. Always been a fan of yellow lightsabers. It's fucking cool.
I've seen some people upset about that.
I've only been upset. The only reason I'm upset is because they never explain how she gets it. Because at least so far in Disney continuity, the only yellow lightsabers you've seen have been used by Jedi Temple Guardians in the Clone Wars TV show. And they are, like, ceremonial weapons that are, like, issued to Jedi Temple Guardians. They're not lightsabers that are built by the Jedi who are stationed as Guardians. They're given to them, they're issued to them. Which means that they're kind of older lightsabers, and they're possibly from the Old Republic. But... since the Jedi didn't make them, it means that we don't have a canon reason of how yellow lightsabers are made in Disney canon. We don't know how they're made.
Does she just show up with it?
Yeah. She buries their lightsabers, and she takes out her lightsaber, and she flips it on, and the blade color is yellow, and that's kind of it. There's no...
Wait, why did she turn on her lightsaber?
Just to see if it works.
Oh, okay. I was like, it's like...
It doesn't show her tinkering with it, though. They just show her take it out, and then she, like, looks at it, and then she turns it on and looks at her lightsaber, and then she, like, kind of turns it off. But there's some other shit, and we'll get to that in a little bit later.
Because I saw the leak for the ending scene where she's like, someone asks who she is.
Yeah, we'll get to that. That's the very last issue I have.
When she says she turns on her lightsaber, she's like, I'm this person.
Well, what did I just say, Pat? We'll get there later.
But I wanted to make the joke.
No, she doesn't say it. She turns on the thing, and then it's like the lady sees her with the lightsaber and asks who she is, and she turns it off.
Okay.
And then she looks over and sees Force Ghost, Luke, and Leia, and then she says, I'm Rey Skywalker. And that's like the end of the movie. Thank you for ruining that, so now we have to come back to that as a second point.
We'll come back to that. That sounds like 30 seconds of film.
It kind of was. Anyway, so... back to the yellow lightsaber. Yes. I'm mad that they didn't explain canon reason of how she has a yellow lightsaber, because at least through some way in the movies they've minorly in some way, shape, or form, or majorly, have essentially said what most of the lightsaber colors are, or at least what they represent. Red is just obviously that's what Sith use. Mm-hmm. If you wanted more information, Marvel came out with the Vader comics from, like, 2011, sometime. At some point. And it's pretty much a recanonization of red lightsaber crystals, and it's essentially, since kyber crystals, or the lightsaber crystals that are used to forge lightsabers, since they are technically living things, they can be made to bleed.
Mm.
So a Sith bleeds a kyber crystal.
That's why
lightsabers are red, because the kyber crystal is bleeding. So, people with blue lightsabers are Jedi. Fuck off! are Jedi Guardians. They are essentially use the Force to protect the way of the Jedi, and essentially they're warriors for the light, and they are characterized by blue lightsabers. Some of the greatest are obviously Obi-Wan and Anakin. And then Jedi Consulars. They use the Force and they study the Force and all the and most of its aspects, or at least the light side. And they use it to augment, and they use the Force to augment themselves, and they really study how to utilize the Force as opposed to being focused on lightsaber combat and dueling.
That's green.
Which is green lightsabers, exactly. So that's why Luke and Obi-Wan. Yeah, Luke, Qui-Gon, and Yoda, they have green lightsabers, they are strong Force users, they study the Force to help them better themselves, as opposed to Obi-Wan and Anakin, who focus more on lightsaber combat to essentially, like, protect the way of the light, essentially, if you want to put that like that.
Yeah. Simple job description.
Yes, the Jedi Guardians, blue lightsabers are essentially, like, the soldiers, if you want to put it in that kind of description. And then in Legends continuity, they're not in Disney, but in Legends there was Jedi Sentinels. And Jedi Sentinels would essentially be like warriors and spies that would go out into the galaxy, and they had yellow lightsabers. And they would utilize the Force and hunt Sith practitioners and eradicate them from the galaxy. Hunt them and kill them, essentially. And they would also focus on, like, a different aspect, like mechanics or, like, computer slicing or something that
Espionage.
Would help. Yeah, just to help them aid in their, like, actual mission of finding and eradicating the dark side. So they're more like spies, like covert spies and warriors, essentially. But we have never gotten a conscious iteration of a Jedi Sentinel in Disney Star Wars, so when she shows up with a yellow lightsaber, everyone's like, is she a Jedi Sentinel? Or at least that's what people are thinking. Personally, I don't think she is, because this is Disney Star Wars, and because the Jedi Guardians have yellow lightsabers, and because, just personally, they have kind of white and gold detail. That's a very characteristic color choice of the Old Republic, so I think that those lightsabers were made during the Old Republic, and they're kind of just weapons that are passed down and utilized in the Jedi Temple Guard issued weapons, essentially.
She just found them between the skip and scenes.
Possibly. Or, here's the other thing, because they're from the Old Republic, the Jedi of the Old Republic have a different, however you want to say, outlook on the Force.
Philosophy.
And yeah, it has a different philosophy on the Force than, say, the current Jedi Council did, or at least I'm making air quotes with my fingers, you can't see it. Current Jedi Council, at least with Mace Windu and Yoda and everybody. That era. Clone Wars era. Pre-Clone Wars era of Jedi Council. That's why I think it's yellow, is because whatever way she understands the Force is somehow closer to how they understood it in the Old Republic. And there's another channel on YouTube you should go subscribe to. He's a cool dude. Star Wars Theory. He said something recently in about one of the recent videos, is that it could symbolize a pure connection, a more pure, untainted connection to the Force, and, like, one of the most purest, one of the purest connections to the actual light side of the Force there is, thus symbolized by an actual, like, yellow lightsaber actually being a true lightsaber. But we don't know for sure, because, once again, this movie, Rise of Skywalker, as well as other movies in this trilogy, don't answer some of the main questions that they raise. At least in the prequel and the original trilogies, however you want to... No matter what questions that they raise, no matter the character development and the plot of the galaxy and like how the story ended and started and everything, whatever answers or whatever questions they asked, they were answered by the end of the movie. And if they weren't answered wholly, there was like a little thing like, hey, we've answered the question, but if you like more information about how this came to be or how we got here, see these books or comics, and it will flesh out that if you desire more information about that. Not, hey, to find the ending of this thing, buy the books or comics. Which is, I feel like, what this new trilogy of movies is doing, is it's...
Is it encouragement to consume more, maybe?
Not necessarily consume more, but it... I mean, yeah. Ultimately, yes, capitalism, consume more, because ultimately it's a Disney product that you would be buying. But ultimately, it just feels like the movie's unfinished, because all your major questions... Shit. Like, the most pressing questions you have, like how Palpatine survived, who Snoke, all this other shit... All that stuff is going to be answered, not in the movie like it should have been, but in third-party media like comics and books.
It'd be like in the prequel trilogy, not showing Order 66 being executed a bit.
Yeah, or not
all
showing...
Someone's like, all the Jedi are all dead. It's like, what?
Yeah, or not showing Anakin's fall to the dark side, and it's just like, he just shows up and he's evil again.
The Academy.
It's like, what the fuck?
Okay.
There's an unfinished story here. And you're gonna just pretend that it's not, and you're going to give us the ending in third-party media when your predecessors in the other versions, not versions of this movie, but the other movies, Star Wars movies, original trilogy and prequels, answered those questions.
And if you're like, oh, what happened to this character? I didn't see him die in the movie. Alternative media.
Here's this alternative. But ultimately, the main characters, the plot was resolved. The questions to those main characters were resolved, not who's Snoke, not how did Ben destroy Luke's entire Jedi temple on Yavin 4. No, those questions aren't answered in the movie. They're answered in third-party media. It comes out in a Marvel comic, which, don't get me wrong, I love Marvel, but I don't feel like that's how you should have to end your movies. Because Marvel movies don't do that. Granted, there's comics for those, but, like, they don't...
They're distinctly separate.
Yes, they're distinctly separate. Not, like, a continuation of the storyline. Read this continuing thing. It's like, imagine having... What's a seminal movie? Imagine having a fucking Jaws.
Yeah.
Okay. And have it end with them going out on the Orca. Not even them, like, getting to the drinking game and them sharing stories about how they got scars and shit. Just, hey, we're on the boat, gonna go hunt the shark. Buy the book to find out what happens.
Is that level?
There's that level of holes.
Oh, I get, yeah, but what's his name? Snoke.
Not just Snoke, but there's some stuff about Kylo we still have no fucking clue about. Some stuff about Palpatine we still got no clue about. Like, what? Like, there's shit we don't know, and that would have been answered otherwise.
I saw in the leaks, there's like the jars of bats of Snoke.
Yeah.
Is that not enough?
Well, it's like, okay, is he a clone? Is he an essence transfer? Was Palpatine using Snoke as like a vessel for his spirit? We don't know those things. How is Palpatine still alive?
Is he still the bodies?
We don't know. We don't know these things. Because these are questions that you have that would have been answered, and at least I feel like would have been answered in the original movies. I say the original movies, I also include the prequels into that. But now are not answered. It's kind of like, what the fuck? So that was one thing with... That was the thing with Rey's lightsaber, is I would have at least liked to see her make it.
Oh, yeah.
Or at the very least... Fuck, I wouldn't even care. You could have had her already have the Kyber crystal.
Let's write one right now.
Or gem or whatever.
Let's write a scene right now.
Just have her have one.
Let's write the scene right now, okay?
Okay, fine. We'll fade it. For most part, beginning of the scene, same part as how it happened in the movie.
I mean, like, getting the sword. She go to the temple to get Leia's saber, or...
No, so in the final thing, Leia's saber is a blue saber, so it's not yellow. But here, we'll do this. We'll rewrite it like this. So, have everything still happen the same way, else have Ben die and all that shit. Let's just say the only thing we're gonna rewrite is just showing Rey's lightsaber.
Ooh, I got one.
Let's have you go first.
Okay. Let's say, I haven't seen the movie.
As someone who hasn't seen the movie, and then I'll go for someone who has seen the movie.
Palpatine's dead. Ben sacrificed himself. She's at the place where he's hanging out, the evil place?
Exegol, the temple, yeah.
Yeah.
Right after, I'm assuming Ben died then.
Yeah, the temple. It's like a Sith temple, right?
Yeah.
Okay, just have like a... The Palpatine defeated or some final thing done. Just like, you know, something calls out to her. It could be a voice, it could be like a shift on the ground. And, you know, there's like a proper sentinel.
like, sent. Like, an unnamed sentinel from the past era.
Okay.
Sent to, like, this is the temple where the ultimate evil is at, Palpatine. Obviously, they fell and died, but as an acknowledgement from the Force or beyond the grave, she is chosen, and those, like, highlighted, like... Or she didn't even reach for, like, Luke or Leia's sword, or whoever's sword. Like, oh, I need my lightsaber.
They have this lightsaber, Anakin's.
Anakin's. She's, like, reaching for Anakin's.
They have Anakin's, and they have, like, Leia's blue saber that she built, too. So they have the two blue sabers there.
Okay.
Two Skywalker sabers there.
Okay, she becomes conscious. Ben's dead. She reaches for Luke's saber. And, it just feels like a shift on the ground to the side. She picks up Luke's saber. She goes to check it out. It's like a fallen sentinel.
I even say Anakin's saber, because it's
Anakin's saber. Yeah, oh, yeah, it's... Luke builds it. But Anakin's saber. And then, there's a shift or something calls out to her. I'm not worried about the details. She goes over, there's a sentinel.
You get what you mean.
Yeah, and that's where, that's the sentinel, like some unnamed great soldier acknowledging her mastery, or her pure light, whatever it symbolizes. And it's that, it's like a, it's even a greater, like, chosenness, or... Not rite of passage, but like, here, this is yours now. You've defeated the ultimate evil.
You've earned this.
Yes. And she grabs that, and then you can save the reveal still for the same ending, or do it right then.
Yeah. Or at least have her show her given a yellow gem of some kind, and you couldn't even say what it was. You're just like, what the fuck is that yellow thing?
Yeah. You can make it parallel to Rey. It could be like a great, like, also female, just Old Republic, unnamed, badass warrior.
The Old Republic? No one's around from then, but yeah.
But like, it's like a ghost from, like, long last time ago.
A great way to canonize Sentinels is just have it be a Sentinel.
Yeah,
just
someone have who, it be a Jedi Sentinel. Sentinel's sent to confront Palpatine in the temple.
Ooh.
And he doesn't give a shit, it's like a trophy to him. That person died. That's me fixing that little thing in, like, it'd be a minute-long scene. 2-minute-long scene at most.
Throwaway 2-minute-long scene, but yeah.
Yeah. But no, it communicates everything, no dialogue needed even.
Yeah, that's true. Very true. My thing is, okay, wait, having seen the movie, let's have it be this way.
Yeah, you got a lot more info.
We'll have Ben die and do all that shit. We'll have it so the ending still happens, they're celebrating and everything, and it cuts to Rey flying the Falcon to Tatooine. And, her flying past the Sandcrawler, Jawa Sandcrawler, and then arriving at the Skywalker, or the Lars farm, I should say. She buries the lightsabers, I'm fine doing all that. I would then like her to see, or then like to see, Hold on. Gotta concentrate. Okay.
I'm just squirming around.
We then cut to her looking inside of the old house there.
All right.
And she finds Luke's old room. And she continues to walk around, and she finds the oil, or the hangar, but, like, essentially, like, workshop or garage area, where Luke gave C-3PO a hot oil bath when they first got him. And it's also where Anakin freaked out and told Padme about him killing the sand people.
Oh, yeah.
Same place.
Yes.
And that is where she takes out all of the components for her lightsaber and lays it down on the ground and starts to meditate on them and use the Force. Essentially goes through a mini-gathering, which, if you don't know, the process of obtaining and building a Jedi lightsaber is called the Gathering. It's something that Padawans go through. And essentially when they assemble their lightsabers, they don't do it with their hands, they meditate on it, and they assemble the lightsaber with the Force.
Do they need the crystal beforehand, or
yes.
Does that appear as... Okay.
You need the crystal beforehand. And while you're building your lightsaber, you meditate on the weapon, and you imbue, essentially, some of your energy into the kyber crystal, and it turns a specific color. It turns whatever color. So, have her meditate on the crystal, whichever crystal it is. You could even just have her have a fucking extra one.
I wanted to add to this. Like, I know it's probably not in the first movies, but, you know, they CGI'd... They CGI'd Han moving his head. They can CGI like a necklace or a
Well, okay, actually,
a wrist thing with a jewel from Anakin's mother.
Hold on, we actually she'd never had anything like that.
I know, but she was CGI.
She was a slave. She had never had anything like that.
I'm just thinking of like a cop out. Not
let me figure. No, here, Pat. So there is a necklace, a medallion in Last Jedi that was obviously of some significance that we never got any significance fucking towards because it's fucking Last Jedi.
Yes.
But it was in Luke's hut in Octo, and it was kind of an amber, reddish looking kyber crystal, or at least part of one. Could have it so Luke goes back and, or Luke, so Rey goes back and gets that, or fuck, she even goes back to Octo and finds Luke's green lightsaber. Because we never fucking see that in this trilogy of movies. So she gets a kyber crystal. However, whatever. I would even just be fine with her, while she unveils all of her components for her lightsaber, she just has a kyber crystal. Even. Yeah. Like, she obtained one.
I think the necklace, or the other stuff's more motivated.
Yes, I like that a little bit more. So then it would be like, oh, here's the callback from Last Jedi. Here's that same medallion thing from Luke's hut. And then she uses it, she meditates on it, she builds her lightsaber that they show her flicking on at the end. And she goes outside, she buries the two lightsabers, and her testing it is her flicking it on the first time that they show them. Mm-hmm. Like, they show her in the movie, and she looks up, and they reveal for the first time that it's a yellow lightsaber. And everyone loses their shit. Alright. And then you have the old lady come in, like, who are you? Anyway. That was the lightsaber thing.
Yeah.
So the last thing, which is her taking the name of Skywalker.
Yes.
I do not fucking like that.
Alright.
That's the biggest thing I didn't like about this entire movie. Mainly because there's like maybe three main issues with it that I have. The first one being it's kind of stupid in the sense it would essentially be the same as like Luke being like, I'm a Kenobi, or even Obi-Wan being like, I'm a Jin, because Qui-Gon Jin trained me, or Luke's like, I'm a Kenobi, because Obi-Wan Kenobi trained me. It's like, what the fuck? No. Yeah. I don't like that shit. The entire purpose of this movie, or at least the entire thing of this movie, is that, spoiler alert, Rey is a Palpatine. Rey is Palpatine's granddaughter. Right? Mm-hmm. And one of the biggest story plot points of this movie was that it doesn't matter. Who the fuck did that?
It's a sniper.
Come here.
He's in the trees, man.
I'm coming for you.
That was a good shot. How do you...
Oh, I'm not coming for you. I'm not coming for you. I changed my mind. Anyway. So, well, it's not Skywalker. So, I don't like that she just calls herself Skywalker, because essentially, like I said, it's like, it kind of devalues the name in a way. But also, I almost said her name. My girlfriend made the joke, or I made the joke to her, that because her and Kylo are like a force dyad, is what the term they give it in the movie for their connection or their bond or whatever. Because they're a Force dyad, they're technically married in the eyes of the Force, thus her name is actually Rey Solo, and because Ben's the last Skywalker, she's technically the last Skywalker by marriage.
Okay.
That's just the joke we make, but obviously that's not the fucking real reason. I don't know what the real reason was, because it was a stupid fucking reason. Like I said, it's pretty much the same thing as Rey being, or as Luke being like, I'm a Kenobi now.
Yeah.
Or even Anakin being like, I'm a Kenobi. I mean, my name's Anakin Kenobi, because I was trained by one.
From the outside, let's be honest, it seems like a way to just to make people clap at the end.
It pretty much kind of is a way to make people clap at the end, quite honestly. For a person that sat through the entire trilogy. But the entire, one of the entire plot points of this whole movie was like, it doesn't matter who your family is, it doesn't matter where you come from, it doesn't matter who you're related to, they don't have any influences who you are as a person or as an individual, your story is your own.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, like, who are you? Rey.
Yeah.
Like, I see it.
Yeah, so it would be cool. The only thing is, here's what I would suggest, alternate ending to this. Her grandfather is essentially Space Hitler.
Yes.
He spent 80 years being a fucking torrential form of oppression and tyranny in the galaxy.
Multiple planets destroyed.
Multiple planets destroyed. See. Multiple actual alien races.
Genocided?
Yes.
Yikes.
So it's not like he was good by any sense of the word. What I would have liked is at the very end when the lady asked, what's your name? I would have loved it if she said Rey Palpatine. Because... granted, your family does not own you, it doesn't make any difference who you are, so why should she affect that concept of Palpatine's being evil affect her? I would have loved if she, like, took onus of the name Palpatine and kind of started or went to turn the view of the name Palpatine around in the galaxy. Like, she would start a new Jedi Order, at least in this context, without Ben, and she would be the new Grand Master. I mean, people, she would face, obviously she would face adversity being a fucking Palpatine, so it's people like, well, okay, is she being two-faced, double-crossing kind of asshole? Is she gonna, like, kill everyone? What's gonna be up? So it's not like it's gonna be easy. It's not gonna be easy by any sense of the word.
But that's endearing. Characters that have a hard time.
Exactly. But that's an endearing, and it's something that I feel like, it's not something she needs to go through. I feel like it would be a nice thing to happen. So it shows that you're right, your family doesn't affect you. So even if your fucking grandfather was the worst piece of shit, you can still be good. And it can still bring the and she could bring the name Palpatine into, like, a better standing in the galaxy.
I think the descendants of Hitler do that with Mein Kampf.
They do.
Don't they donate all the proceeds? Because it's still, I think it's still public. Or it's not public domain yet, but the proceeds go to charities.
But yeah, go to charities of Jewish families who are affected in the Holocaust. So
there's a real world parallel they could have done.
There is. There's a very real world parallel, and I wish they kind of would have done that with her. Because not only that, it kind of was like, yeah, girl, own that shit. You're fucking Palpatine. Hell yeah, you are.
Here's his legacy.
Turn this shit around. Yeah. You are his legacy, and show him how everything that he believed in was right in some way, just it wasn't from a certain point of view. Pun intended. No, but pretty much say, like, he was right with some things that he was thinking, that, like, the galaxy was not, like, was not being run effectively, it was being corrupt, but he went about his methods the worst way possible.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just said it. Palpatine had some good ideas.
Some
shit was bad, but other shit wasn't that bad. So, like, I just feel like, oh shit, every time, motherfucker!
Damn.
I just feel like it would have come full circle with that.
Yeah.
Because, truly full circle if you want to get into it, been like, because he started out as being a positive person. Quote-unquote positive person in the galaxy. Mm-hmm. Being, like, a senator from Naboo.
Is that his direct origin?
Yes, he's from Naboo. Huh. He was born on Naboo.
So, Senator
Amidala?
No, I mean,
Padme?
Sidious? Is it Sidious before he switches his name?
His name is Darth Sidious. His name is, Sheev Palpatine.
Oh.
It's his name. His name is Palpatine.
Palpatine. Okay. So in the first movie, he's secretly Sith, but he's already done all the...
Oh, yeah.
He's already converted to the dark... Yeah, okay.
He was converted to the dark side when he was, like, fucking 17.
Okay, he's hiding in plain sight.
He's been in hiding in plain sight. Okay. Every single Force user... Oh, here, wait, real quick. Just to get back to... Before we get into that, we're going to talk about some casual Star Wars stuff in a little bit. But just to get back to the Rise of Skywalker, that's the very last thing that I didn't like. I didn't like that she didn't take the name Palpatine and, like, kind of own up to it and be like, fuck yeah, that's who I am, kind of. I did not get him at all.
What about the ghosts?
Force ghosts? The only two Force ghosts that they show are Luke and Leia, and that's at the very end when she, buries their lightsabers on Tatooine. Whoa! Damn it. The other thing, and this is just me being a fanboy and, like, wishing I could have gotten this, the other thing I wish I could have had just in the entirety of the movie is I wanted Hayden Christensen to show up as Force Ghost Anakin. Whether that be in the final confrontation with Palpatine, and here's two ways I see it going down. First way, just go with close to what it was in the movie. There's a fight on Endor, which Rey has. It's the fight where they're, like, where they're on the ruins of the Death Star, and it's kind of, like, all on the ocean and shit.
Oh, yeah, the water.
Yeah, the water. Water fight.
The trailer, yeah.
The direct opposite to Obi-Wan and
Anakin's
fight on Mustafar. Oh, God. That was a really good fight, by the way. It's probably the best fight in the trilogy, but that's also because we only got about two fights in this entire trilogy. So the way that pretty much shit went down is, Rey stabs Ben through the chest with a lightsaber, and then she force heals him, and then she just kind of leaves him there, and he has a weird existential moment. Mm-hmm. And he talks to the memory of his father, the memory of Han Solo. Actually, Han Solo, and I can guarantee you most people who saw it was like, Han Solo's a force ghost, because they made it fucking confusing. But no, he's like talking to the memory of his father.
Okay.
And he pretty much just says, like, you're a good kid, and they kind of parallel the Force Awakens conversation when Kylo stabs him through the chest.
Mm-hmm.
Literally parallel, same lines.
Okay.
So it's not bad. And then he, like, throws his lightsaber into the ocean, and Ben Solo, or Kylo Ren redemption arc is done. He is now Ben Solo. At that point, I would like him to turn around, and Hayden Christensen is there with a Force Ghost blue aura around him, and just be like, "Hey, kid." And obviously, this isn't what he would like. Obviously, not word for word. These are just along the lines like, "I've been with you your entire life." I've been with Luke his entire life. I never left. I've been trying to talk to you since you fell, and trying to explain to you that Darth Vader is not something to worship. In fact, he's not a whole different person. Darth Vader and Anakin Skywalker are the same person. It was just me being a child and hiding behind a mask and essentially trying to hide behind the decisions that I made, and I wasn't strong enough to face them, so I hid and just fell further until Luke saved me, or saved him, whatever.
Yeah.
And he's like, and then he could say, like, and the same thing has finally happened with you, but with Rey. And then he could say how I've been trying to talk to you for your entire life, or at least the 10 years, however many years, you've been on, essentially fall into the dark side. Thanks, dude, that ran in front of me. But since you fell to the dark side, the only reason I haven't been able to talk to you is because Palpatine hasn't been, or he's essentially found a way, so I can't talk to you. There's the line in the movie that Palpatine is every voice that Ben has heard inside his head. Ben has heard, like, Darth Vader, he's heard Palpatine, he's heard Snoke throughout the years. And the movie confirms that it's just been Palpatine the entire time. So I would have liked that it's kind of like, no, Palpatine is... Because then it also shows a testament to how ludicrously powerful Palpatine is, that he can essentially counter Force Ghosts, which is just a physical embodiment of light side energy.
When he becomes Ben again.
And when he becomes Ben again, he actually...
suddenly opened.
Yeah, he can actually talk to them again. So once he sees them, he can actually talk to his grandpa, and he pretty much says, like, I've been trying to talk to you, I just couldn't because Palpatine's been blocking you.
He gives him the call to action.
He gives him his call to action, and then that's when he goes and turns and he does his whole thing. And then the follow-up, which could be, either you could do it so it's this thing just by itself, or it's a conjunction of the two. I feel like it would be stronger if it's Ben and Anakin talking on Endor, and then this follow-up thing. Rey is having a showdown with Palpatine, and she's kind of losing, she's kind of out of it. And she, like, asks, she kind of says a prayer, when she's looking up at the sky, she says, be with me. And, like, all these fallen Jedi Masters are, like, saying that you can, essentially, kind of like, you can do it, kind of a thing. But... when that happens, they're kind of also, like, giving their energy to her so that she can fight Palpatine again.
Yeah. She's doing the spirit bomb. Yes.
Essentially. So, what I want to have happened is I want, I want every Force Ghost to be, like, an actual Force Ghost, a disembodied voice, and then when she starts to get up again, amendment to the movie real quick, Ben Solo would not have to have been yeeted down the fucking pit for this.
Again.
He has to be at least, or at the very least, he's like knocked out or something.
Oh, I think I see where you're going.
And he's injured. So, Rey's getting up after she sees she's gotten the energy from the Force Ghost, and Palpatine is advancing on her, and she's not getting up quick enough. And she looks back, and she sees this blue glow behind her, and she turns around, and just stepping out of the ether and materializing before her and corporealizing into a human figure is Anakin Skywalker, Hayden Christensen. Mm. And he walks up, and it's essentially mimics the Yoda-Palpatine fight from Episode 3, except it's now Anakin in Yoda's place, and it's now just a Force duel. And he's essentially using Tuta Menis to hold the lightning, Palpatine's Force lightning, at bay. And he essentially, and he just turns around and he looks at Rey and he just says, like, pick up my grandson and go. And then she, like, picks him up, puts him into Red 5, puts him in the X-Wing that that Rey came on while Ben's still knocked out, and they fly out of there, and Anakin's left to defeat Palpatine at the end.
I'm thinking more DBZ, Gohan versus Cell, where she's doing the final blow, and on her shoulder it's Hayden's on her shoulder, and even Luke. This way does it invalidate Luke or Anakin,
yes,
as being the chosen ones, and the three of them together defeat the dark side.
That'd be good too. I didn't think about that. But ultimately, so it's like, it's not just that way, so.
That way is, yeah. It's
that
not
way they're
just,
they're there.
Yeah.
And it's like.
And it is nostalgic and a bit fan service-y, but.
It's very
fan service-y,
but it's like, I would take that because that's immediately a better ending.
Than what? Yeah.
Because just describing it, I'm getting partial chills from it.
I love that. It's.
Whereas, yeah, to what we got. Not just Dragon Ball, but just, like, the new ending we just described, how it's...
Look at that thing go. Whoa, look at him go!
He doesn't have arms!
This is a new clone. I've never seen a clone like
it's
this.
It's a new model.
Ah! Is that or is the robot's genitalia? Those are both jokes to be made. Because you see the legs? I see that. I gotta go to a doctor.
He's, like, looking at me like, what's up, dude? He's a member on my team.
That's a person?
Yes!
It must be like a Ethan. Is it a connection thing? Oh yeah, I see the name.
I have no idea if it's a connection thing. If it is, that's fucking hilarious. But anyway, that's one of the main things I felt like at the very end of the movie, is I was like, this is a decent ending, but like, it
could have done a lot better.
It could have done a lot better, but also feels like it devalues Anakin and Luke's sacrifice and their stories.
Yes.
It makes it feel like they are not the chosen one. Or neither of them were the chosen ones, at least. Granted, the whole prophecy of the chosen one, I thought was, like, subjective. I feel like it's a chosen one for a generation type thing. So, like, the chosen one will rise, and it just so happens these two times were Skywalkers.
Or it's like, they...
Because arguably, at least in KOTOR, the chosen one is Darth Revan.
Yeah.
He's not a Skywalker, but still, the Chosen One will rise to combat evil and all the
light and dark.
Yeah, exactly. There's balance and all the other shit. But besides that, there's the fact of... headset. There's just the fact that they're supposedly built to be the Chosen One, and they're both ludicrously powerful, and people have thought they are each the Chosen One, so then, at least by having, like you just said, having Rey, Anakin, and Luke stay there. I honestly, personally think it would be cool if it was Anakin and Luke that finish it. And Rey gets Ben out of there.
I think, but
it just
takes agency away from Rey.
Exactly, yeah. It takes agency away from Rey. But, so I feel like she should be there to defeat him. Or to help Anakin and Luke, and they all three defeat him. So that way it doesn't devalue any of the protagonists and any of the chosen ones through the three generations.
Yeah. I can see if you structure it as... Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Rey does a big blow, and then Anakin and Luke finish. give her a thing of, like...
Or
there's enough fighting. No more fighting. You gotta save a life. And then Ben is that life. And we'll handle this.
Yeah, we'll handle this.
I can see that working as well.
Like, once again... Either subjective, just to however we want to take it, but there is a better way to do it.
Or even if they just neutralize them, like, there's no defined winner. They, as far as she leaves the planet and the dark force is neutralized, like, it could be the three of them are constantly there in combat.
Forever?
Eternal spirits.
Jesus.
The counter to the, yeah, or they could win, but I see your direction as well.
Yeah.
But you'd have to build it.
You have to build it the right way, exactly, yeah. But yeah. At least that's my way of doing it. And that's what I think of Rise of Skywalker, and that should be enough.
Yeah, I hate when you watch a movie that's alright and good in some places, but, like, you sit around bullshit stuff that you think would have been better.
The ultimate thing is, I told this to Shanti. Well, it's out now. I told this to Shanti when I got out of the movie theater with her. And I was just like, I feel like we just watched some fairly not well-written fan fiction where the dude was pressed at work or he had stressful school lives and he didn't have a chance to finish the story that he wanted, so he just kind of cobbled together what he could and he sent it out there.
Get a deadline to meet.
It is, he was stressed out with his finals, he had his final term paper to write, and he was under the gun, and this is what we got instead of the big ludicrous...
I like our fan fiction better.
Our fan fiction is better. I'm going to read fan fictions later in a couple of weeks, probably once I'm giving them time to be written.
Oh yeah.
I know they're being written. Giving them time, and then I will read better fan fictions than this movie, like I did with Last Jedi. I read better fucking fan fictions than the actual movie.
We just wrote ours. You can't trademark. You can't take those ideas.
TM.
No ideas. You can't take the Goku thing.
I've been here by myself. Oh, there's another dude. Cool. It's an Instagram-looking dude. The Instagram model.
IG. What the
heck?
Hi. I forgot the censor's name.
Bitch. That was a good talk.
Yeah.
The main complaint was it had nothing to do with what I felt. It felt eerily reminiscent to Game of Thrones, where it was not the actor's fault. It was through the part of the writers being just lazy and not wanting to think about how to best end the situation that they wrote themselves into a corner and just kind of shit in their hand, fling it on the wall and say, I did it.
You know I am about Disney, but I think it's same thing, but I'd say it's not lazy. I'd say it's just more corporate, like, write the fucking pages, scriptwriter. Write the fucking stuff. We got toys to ship.
Well,
here's
the thing. While I do agree with you, Disney just being corporate, I feel like with Disney Star Wars, that's more of a precedent. With Marvel, I would say it's a complete exact opposite because they've learned, like, let directors have their spin on their certain movies. Because it will bring in more money. They'll be differentiated. They'll be a diverse... Whoa. What the fuck? There'll be a diverse collection of movies in your library of MCU movies.
There's this, like, yeah, it's cookie cutter, but there is
there,
more
it's cookie
control.
Cutter, but there is more control, and it's rare for you to, like, write your own script. They give you certain story beats you have to hit, but for the most part, they're like, get there how you want, as long, at least in their case, as long as it's well fucking written.
Yeah.
Just like, get there.
I was gonna say Ant-Man with Paul Rudd, just like the bit with he gives the daughter the toy.
Yeah.
That's such good writing to have. They're like, oh, it's hideous. I love it. It's like, okay, that characterizes the young girl character you see.
Exactly. More characterization of that young girl than the entire first two movies for Rey. I'm gonna be real honest, because I want to try to like this character.
You're going in R.
No, I only ended up liking her after Rise of Skywalker, and that's because it's like, where was these, like, two movies worth of exposition and character development?
Were the lines giving us hints to the insight?
Exactly. Granted, there's only so much you could, like, derive from shittily written dialogue, so...
Yeah. They're playing it safe with their dialogue instead of, like, we're gonna have the young girl who's like, oh, I love it, daddy, or that's lazy writing. I think better writing is, like, give her a personality and her eight lines.
Exactly. She may only have eight lines, but those eight lines are going to essentially tell you who this person is.
Yes.
And you're going to have a sense of who this character is to the point where, like, you actually know someone like that.
Yes.
As opposed to just...
I'm the hero. Yes.
I'm also a woman.
Killing is wrong.
I'm not as good as Wonder Woman, and I hate the media because of that.
Oh.
Because Wonder Woman is a well-written movie. Sorry. Wow, shit!
I have my Wonder Woman issues. I think you know them.
Oh, no. I absolutely have my Wonder Woman issues. It's mainly the fucking fight at the end.
Oh, mine's with the setting.
I give you the setting, too.
Yeah. Pseudo-Nazis in World War One? Come on.
It's also because there weren't Nazis in World War One.
Yeah, but don't put it in World War One then. If it's World War One's about nationalism, then
Well, isn't about nationalism, but true.
All sides did pretty horrible
stuff. The real reason they actually put it in World War One is
because Captain America came out.
No, it's because there's a Wonder Woman comic, and in the first iteration, she actually gets exposed to humanity. It's during World War One, and that's where she set. That's what helps set her precedent as men as a fucking bloodthirsty, absolutely fucking awful species and race of people, and that's why she fucks off and doesn't want anything to do with them for 50 years.
I would have liked that better than I've just seen the parts of the Dreamboat.
Ooh.
Captain Kirk actor.
Chris Pine.
Yeah, where it's
what the fuck?
Whoa! Nice.
Well, I'm safe here.
Can you help Obi-Wan? You
no, leave? He's good. He's got it.
High ground meme, yes.
Suck it, Obi-Wan.
That's cool.
There's a
wall on you, though.
This is a cap. This is the ceiling.
Yeah. Invisible.
There's no one would ever go this high.
You're allowed at least.
I know. I can lift shit. I'm staying up here. It's official. I don't care if we lose. I'm not giving up. See, I'm not wandering off. I'm up here.
But yeah, that's my one thing.
No, yeah.
It seemed like she took a side and oh, it's American. Not
she very
American
much
audiences. Americans not that, but
it was very much.
It simplified the conflict.
It was written for a movie.
Yeah.
As opposed to that was one of the issues. One of the things where I was like, it was a great DC Comics movie, just because the standard hasn't been set so high. Yeah. It was just also a good movie with a female protagonist. It's because at least in that instance, I felt like she's competent. Mm-hmm. And she just so happens to have a vagina.
Okay. It's a good character.
It's like Ripley. It's like Ellen Ripley. It's
good
like
good character who happens to be a woman.
Yes, exactly. Not your defining aspect is that they are a woman. Like Captain Marvel.
Ah, you're gonna get us canceled. I already messed up.
No, we're fine.
Shit, what's a good joke movie? I mean, what's a good movie? I love Parasite, that was good. Think about those characters.
You love what?
You saw Parasite?
Oh,
no.
Yeah.
That Korean film?
No.
Okay.
But I know what happens in it.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that it's not good. I understand it.
I like the characters.
I like the characters too.
Even the ones I don't even fully understand all of them. That's a good sign.
It's a good and bad sign. For that movie, in the case where I feel like that's what it was going for, it's a good sign.
Yeah.
When it's a film like Star Wars where you have to have fleshed out characters, that's a very bad sign. What the fuck did I just walk into?
Just hold on for a little longer. Miniguns on you.
That's the problem. Alright, I feel like that's a good start.
That's a good
in-depth Star Wars talk. We'll be back probably playing
Star Wars.
More Star Wars and having casual Star Wars talks later. Alright, everybody.
Alright.